From the guys who bring you NBA Unplugged. This will be a short segment that will kind of break down each of the NBA Finals games day by day as they happen. Your host is Jacob Noble from the ProBasketballTalk.com. Alongside of me, as always, is the famous Brian Geltzeiler from Hoops Critic. How are we doing today, Brian?
Jacob, I'm wonderful. How are you, my friend?
Fantastic. And what game did we have in game one? That was fantastic basketball. It shattered all ratings for any NBA Finals game one in the world, 11% nationwide. You had over 30% in each market. You couldn't ask for a better game.
Game was a great game, and you know, no matter what markets you have here, Jacob, when you get the two best players that the NBA has to offer going up against each other, not playing together, but going up against each other, it is always going to be good for the business of basketball.
Absolutely, and I like that little dig you had. I don't know if you implied that dig at Dwayne Wade, because he is not a top five player right now. In fact, I don't even put him in the top 15 the way he's been playing. Let's talk about Dwayne Wade for a second, because I think he's getting off easy, and it might be because he has a championship, and he's brought a lot to City Miami, but there's no excuse for his defense, and you and I kind of highlight his lack of defense that he has constantly. Let's talk a little bit about what you saw in game one.
Well, you know, there's things that I saw that didn't go well for him that don't trouble me. You know, Russell Westbrook's a tough matchup for him. He's going to struggle with Westbrook. It's just going to be that way. Westbrook, at this stage of the game, is twice the athlete he is. So that's something I saw. It didn't surprise me, and it certainly wasn't something that's disturbing. Disturbing parts of his game have to do with running back on defense. He has become one of the poorer transition defense players in the world because he treats running back on defense as optional. And it's a huge problem for the Heat, and it's an even huger problem in this series because of how well Oklahoma City runs. The other thing that's very disturbing about Wade is how his shot selection has absolutely deteriorated. When he's struggling to get good shots off, his antidote is not to work harder for better shots, it's to take more bad shots. He took a mountain of bad shots last night. He had an awful game, but here's the problem. For him these days, the games like last night are much more the norm than when you look at a game four or a game five against Indiana where he went truly nuts.
Yeah, and that's going to be troublesome, especially for, you know, the king, LeBron James, on the other side, because he came to Miami because he didn't want to have to do everything he's doing. For him to have a 30 points and 11 rebound series to eliminate the aging, old, injured Celtics, embarrassing to LeBron James, in my opinion, at least, Brian, because he went down there to get help. He went down there to get guys to get him over the hump. Yes, he's gone to the finals two straight years, but if they continue to play the way they did in game one, where, you know, it's basically LeBron a bust, that's not what he signed up for. And maybe we should start breaking down his game, and maybe his game is the reason why others don't get involved. But it's so mind-boggling, Brian, because he passes the ball well. He gets all the teammates involved, but I feel like people who play with LeBron expect him to do everything for him. And, you know, maybe that's the burden of being a great player.
So I agree with you. I think first, he came here with an entirely different set of expectations. Never expected to have all the pressure be on him here in Miami. And if all the pressure was going to be on him here in Miami, he was better off staying in Cleveland. The thing is this, he thought he joined a better team than what he joined. This is it's a very good basketball team. I'm not sure it's a great basketball team. I do think in this era of parity in the NBA, where you have a lot of spread out very good teams, I think they could be good enough to still win a title. But it's a deeply flawed team. It's far from a perfect team. And one of the major problems, most significant problems going on right now, is how poorly Dwayne Wade is playing. And he expected to get more from Wade. Him and Wade have gone to not playing together at all anymore. And even simple things like James would expect Wade to be able to do for him, like feed him in the post, are enormous challenges for Dwayne Wade. I think what was very damning and indicting of Dwayne Wade last night was the fact that Eric Spoelstra, for a very short amount of time, went with a lineup with no point guard. He did it for about 6 minutes. That's been a staple of his in the playoffs, with Wade as the smallest guy on the floor. A lot of it has to do with the fact that Wade has been so poor handling the ball on the perimeter and so sloppy with it that he really needed another ball handler on the floor in Chalmers, and it compromised him being able to go with an advantageous look.
And we'll finish up this Miami Heat side of things. But to me, Ryan, I don't see Wade making many easy baskets. And the baskets he is making are incredible shots. And we saw a few of them last night. They're just incredible shots. You look at that, you're like, how the hell did that go in? But that's what he does. But he's not making things easy on him. And I think he needs to figure out how to make things easy on him. And you pointed it out last year in the playoffs where LeBron got him going. And even this year with the Indiana Pacers series, he got him going by getting him easy buckets and got him Wade into a rhythm. And if LeBron's going to have to play the point forward, I think Miami might be in trouble here. But let's shift gears a little bit. Let's talk about the Oklahoma City Thunder. Because the big question was being able to get to the rim. That was a big question I had in the San Antonio series, as you saw that there wasn't going to be a problem, and it proved to be right. Ended up getting to the basket fairly easy. But in this series, game one, especially late in the second half, their ability to get to the rim, in my opinion, made the difference in this game.
It certainly did, and the Heat, which is normally a strong, health defense team, didn't help out wonderfully. I mean, what killed the Heat in the game last night, and even worse in the fourth quarter, was the amount of switching they did on picks. You know, there's a ton of pick and roll in the half court. You're switching every time, and when you're going to switch every time, so switching sometimes is okay. You can mix up a look. I'm all for that, Jacob. However, when you switch as frequently as the Heat switched last night, you guarantee the Thunder to get every matchup they want. And when you look at some of the guys that ended up matched up in Durant off switches, I saw Chalmers on him for a possession. I saw Wade on him for a possession. They had Bosch on him out on the perimeter. You can't be switching to that extent that they can have exactly who they want guard their best player. And that was really, it was a bad thing by the Heat last night. Because they ended up in that situation, yes, the Thunder got to the rim easily, but the Thunder did everything they wanted to do in the second half. Everything was easy to them.
Absolutely. The Heat did not make the second half adjustments that they're usually doing, especially in the Boston series in games 6 and 7. They made those adjustments in the second half, and that proved to be the winners of those two games, whether it was LeBron going in, you know, kill mode or whatever it was. But the thing that's interesting in this series, Brian, and I should say interesting in Oklahoma City basketball, is the fact that Durant is scoring so efficiently that he makes Westbrook look like a bad player, or vice versa. Westbrook's inefficiency makes Durant look like the most efficient player I have ever seen play the game of basketball. It's truly amazing to watch. They both shoot up the same amount of shots, but Durant's averaging 10-plus more points a game. And when he gets it going, and that is the difference. And you saw in that fourth quarter why the comparisons and contractions between Durant and LeBron are more than ever. LeBron is an all-around better player. I don't think many people can doubt that. But when it comes to scoring in the fourth quarter, I don't think there's someone better than Durant in the league this day.
Yeah, absolutely. But I will tell you, if you're going to pitch stars against each other, I will tell you, I don't think the story of that game last night was LeBron versus Durant. The story of that game was Westbrook versus Wade. And Westbrook outplayed Wade 10 ways coming and going. The thing is this about Westbrook and his shots. Westbrook is such an unbelievable athlete. He can get himself a good shot in the floor most times. I don't look at his shot numbers and worry so much because he's going to take plenty of shots. Westbrook is just a guy who's got a penchant for missing easy shots. But he's such a streak player, and he's so brilliantly talented. You don't want to ever get him away from taking the good shots that he can create. So ultimately, when I watch Westbrook play, it's never about how many shots he took. It's never even about how many shots he missed. It's not about quantity, but the quality of the shot. Last night, most of his shots were good shots. You know, he went about 2 of 9 in the first half, and we went 2 of 9 in the first half. Most of the shots were good shots. He didn't take any bad ones, and that's the key to Westbrook, because eventually, if he keeps taking the good shots, he's going to hit the good shots, and most of the time, like last night, hit him at the more important parts of the game.
The thing to me about Westbrook is I thought he took some bad shots in the first half, so I kind of disagree with you there. I felt like he saw the switching matchups and he thought he could shoot over people. I mean, that's not his game. I like Westbrook when he's going to the basket. And I felt like in the second half he did that more. He adjusted his game. He saw what the defense was giving them and adjusted. And that's where I agree with you on your statement there. So I disagree and I agree with you on that part. Let's jump on more to the third-tier stars because I felt like they did not have a staple in this game. Chris Bosh and James Harden. They weren't hurt. They didn't have any big moment plays in the game. It was mostly about the two stars and the two stars.
It was. They both struggled, but you know, it's interesting because the Thunder were able to overcome Harden's struggles rather easily. You know, Harden didn't play wonderful on offense, but that wasn't even where he hurt the Thunder. He hurt the Thunder defensively last night. They put him on LeBron for a little while, which is a bad idea. And he just struggled there. But, you know, listen, they got through without him. I think you'll see Harden resume his normal role in the next game. Bosh is a huge concern. Because all of a sudden, Bosh has decided he's a three-point shooter and needs to be out on perimeter. Because he hit a handful in a game seven. He's a very good offensive rebounder. When he's hanging out on the perimeter by the three-point line, he takes himself away from offensive rebound. Okay? Decent post player, too. Can't get the ball in the post when you're hanging on the perimeter. Plus, hanging on the perimeter after the three-point line takes him out of the screen and roll game. The Heat's most valuable offensive play, Jacob, is that little pick and pop with either LeBron or Wade running it for Bosh for the corner jumper. So they got to get Bosh much more involved in this game in the paint. And the other thing with Bosh is that his health defense was absolutely awful last night. Whether it was fatigue, whether it was the groin, he was running in sand last night. And with the way Oklahoma City attacks the basket, they're going to need much better help defense out of Chris Bosh.
That might be the make or break of that game, Brian, because Chris Bosh lost his mind for a minute. He thought he was a three-point shooter. When you're talking about the Miami Heat, they shoot threes fairly easily. You know, Battier had it going on last night. Chalmers hit a couple. They got James Jones. They got Norris Cole. They got three-point shooters. Bosh, you're not out there to be a three-point shooter. You're out there to do the things that they don't have. And as you just pointed out, they don't have interior presence. They don't have an interior defense right now. It's all LeBron all day. So, Chris Bosh, you got to get back into your zone. Know what you do best and do it best. You got any more for this quick, in the penalty, if we were really playing the game, this team would have been in the penalty about 2 minutes into the game in the fourth quarter.
Fair enough. Don, good first night. That was a good cookie, my friend.
Absolutely. And we'll talk again soon, especially after game two.